gentlemen, we're leaving this noisy area. We've got enough.
The driver. What was your name again?
Jean-Pierre, who's gonna do this well crazy job to most of you, I would imagine, driving us on the wrong side of the road. We already boarded the train on the other side, and now we're gonna drive it on the wrong side of the road. Yes, in New Caledonia, we have the European sort of system of driving here. So brace yourself. Also, just in case if you guys are gonna need us to stop the little train urgently, and the top left corner of every carriage, top left corner under the ceiling in the middle, you've got two red square buttons that say stop. Top left, left side under the ceiling, two red square buttons that say stop. Those are our emergency buttons. So if you need us to stop the train urgently, push that button on. Otherwise, as you can see, no windows. So please do not push that button to stop for picture taking. I'm gonna ignore that one. This I can promise you. And also, guys, hold on to anything that can fly away. Your hats, scarves, and so on. Because there might be a few windy corners around the Noumea Peninsula. So hold on to it, because you might get a little blast of wind once in a while. Now, quick explanation as to why your beautiful cruise ship is docked over here in the cargo terminal, which is a very unexcited part of the capital for you, of course. That's simply because Carnival cruise ships, just like Princes and Rhapsodies, are the large ones, which means you're just not going to fit into our passenger terminal. What you guys need to know is that you have arrived in a small country with small islands, tiny capital, tiny population. Everything else that follows is proportionally tiny over here. So our passenger terminal, it's a tiny thing. You have a beautiful cruise ship, but you just wouldn't fit in there. So that's why we docked you over here on the side of the city. Now, to compensate you for this slight discomfort, we have organized free shuttle buses that will take you... Oops. Here we go. Just buckle up that train there. And don't do that again. You do it again, you're going to run behind the train. I'm joking, don't worry, guys. Brace yourself, I have a very bad sense of humor on top of that. Now, we have organized you free shuttle buses to take you out of the container area, and they're going to bring you directly to passenger terminal, which is about 2-3 minutes away from here. We're going to see it very shortly. Now, the shuttle buses are free of charge. You do not have to pay for them. As soon as one fills up, it leaves, another one comes in, and so on, and they're going to carry on like this all day until you guys leave this afternoon. Now, the last shuttle bus will leave passenger terminal 15 minutes before you have to come back to the boat this afternoon. This is the boat time you have to come back. The same spot where the shuttle bus drops you off at the passenger terminal, this is the same place where they're going to pick you up later on after you've done doing whatever it is you're going to do in the city center. Now, the passenger terminal, you guys can already see it on the right hand side of the map. And as we're going to come out at the corner of the road, you guys are going to see at the very end of this long car park, you're going to see a building on the harbour that has a big white roof that looks like a tent, and there's a big white mast coming out of the harbour. The terminal that with the shuttle buses will take you to, and they will pick you up later on from the same spot where they drop you off, and they will bring you back all the way to the cruise ship. Now, don't walk this distance over here, because one, as you can see, there is absolutely nothing interesting to see on the way. Two, security at the gates will stop you, and they will not allow you to walk between the containers for your safety and security. So quite frankly, you're just going to waste your time walking over there, and on top of that, you're going to have to wait for someone to pick you up that's going to bring you in to the cruise ship area. So once again, guys, memorize this building very well. On the way back, we're not going to drive in front of it, but we're not going to be far from here. So I'm going to remind you everything. Now, on your right hand side ahead of us, at the end of that car park, you've got that big white roof building with the mast in the center. That is your passenger terminal, and the shuttle buses will stop on the side. On the first floor of the passenger terminal, you've got souvenir stands just under the roof. On the ground floor, there is a tourist information point where you can stamp your passport hopefully for your visit over here. There's exchange point where you can exchange your money back and forth from your home money to local Pacific franc currency. and there are toilet facilities, free Wi-Fi connection available over there as well, and then snack and other restaurant, and also other tour operators that can organize you other activities over here. So this is all happening at the passenger terminal. And if you want to go for a walk to the city center and do a bit of shopping or browsing around the boutique shops or souvenir shops, well, this is where we're going to start our tour. The passenger terminal is one block behind us. City center is one block ahead of us. So it's a walking distance. Otherwise, if you want to go to the beach areas in Noumea, you're going to have to grab a local transport or some other transport and go to the south side of the capital, which is far, far away from here on the right-hand side at the end of peninsula. And we're going to go there with the little train as well. In the meantime, we have entered the downtown area, the so-called city center over here on Noumea. Now, like I said to you guys, everything is tiny over here, proportionally tiny. So, of course, the city center is not going to be huge. Alba Road, this is the name of this particular road, is considered over here in Noumea to be the longest and the largest shopping high street. We want you to laugh, because if you poke your heads outside, you're going to see the end of it. That's how big it is. But hey, we keep it tiny over here. This is our largest high street over here, so yes. Now, usually this part of the downtown area is the more expensive one. So this is where you usually find some more expensive shops, duty-free stuff, some designer things as well, usually better quality things as well. The shops here are usually open from about 8:30, 9:00 until about 5:30, 5:30 or 6:00. Supermarkets very often stay open all day long from 7 till 7. Now, a long time ago, it was like a religion for everyone over here to close the shops for lunchtime and the siesta. Today, well, everybody has to pay the bills, the life is expensive for everyone, so it's up to the shopkeeper very often. And usually, half of the shops stay open, half of the shops close for lunchtime. Usually it's a good time to take lunch anyway and then go shopping in the afternoon. So just bear that in mind, that some of the shops might be closed between 11:30 and 1:30 or 12 and 2. On your right hand side here, you've got my leg. This is the largest, the corner shop over here. This is the largest duty-free shop. And if you guys are wondering, what are those posters around the shop saying sold? Well, this is sale time. This is the winter sale. So well done for coming here, because you might be anxious to grab a nice promotion or discount, because we've got our winter sales. And bear in mind, we're always very excited about the winter sales over here, simply because everything is always expensive here. But yes, we've got a lot of stuff imported over here in New Caledonia. There's a tiny population, not many people make things, so we have to import a lot of stuff. And usually things are very expensive, but hey, it's the sales time, so go for it, guys. We're gonna have some cheap stuff in the shops, hopefully. Later on our journey, I'm gonna go through the exchange rate with you guys. The Australian dollar at the moment is around 80 francs, New Zealand dollar around 70 francs, and American dollar around 100 francs. So whatever prices you see, local prices, you just have to divide it by the one that you've got on you. Right, on our right-hand side, as we're going to take a turn, we're going to have our first historical building monument, which is still in use until today. That's our old Protestant church, which was built by the convicts over here in the 19th century. It's up the hilltop. It's a Protestant church that is still in use until today by the Protestant communities over here. And inside of that church, you've got beautiful music organs, which were made in Sydney, in Australia. Following up on the right-hand side here at the corner, we've got a small building with those beautiful wooden sculptures outside. Well, this is our tiny parliament. Tiny building, only 54 members in our parliament. That's how many of them are there. And they are all chosen from three provinces into New Caledonia, which into New Caledonia is kind of divided, the south, the north of the mainland, and the Loyalty Islands. And on the left-hand side, behind the black gate, this is the House of High Commissioner. The High Commissioner over here represents the French government that colonized New Caledonia a long time ago. So he's been hiding there for many years, but since about 2 years, his role became more symbolical than practical. So, because he doesn't have as much to say anymore, he tends to come out a little bit more often. Now, I'm going to clear the politics out of the way right now, since we started to talk about our parliament and the High Commissioner. And after that, we're going to start our tour right from the beginning. So New Caledonia, at the moment, is not quite an independent country just yet. The status of our country is comparable to overseas territory. The unique status allows us to have our own president and our own government, which has 11 members. And the president and the government, the president and the government are located in the opposite corner from this corner of the city. They are located in the opposite corner of the downtown area. Aside of that as well, we've got a 16-member Kanak Senate to represent the indigenous population called Kanaks. Since 2010, New Caledonia officially has two flags representing the country. The French one, the tricolor one, blue, white and red, and the Kanak flag. That has a blue, red and green horizontal stripe, yellow circle in the middle, and a black totem on top of that circle. Every citizen of New Caledonia has a French passport. There's no such thing as a New Caledonian passport at the moment. So that means that all the citizens of New Caledonia are automatically European Union members. And that's pretty good for studying and traveling. However, if you'd like to work over here in New Caledonia, things get a little bit more complicated. First and French, then European, then everyone else. What does that mean? If you have a French passport, you can work here in this country as long as you want, and you don't need any documents. If you have a European passport, to stay here, you don't need anything. You can stay here as long as you want, but to work, you need to apply for documents. And if you come from outside of Eurozone, you can stay here 3 months on the tourist visa, which you can very easily obtain at the airport on arrival. And then to stay longer, you need one document, and to work, you need another one. This was created to protect local employment. There is a multi-party system over here in New Caledonia as well, which is quite complex and complicated. Most parties, the main sort of parties are about eight, and the main issue dividing all of them, of course, is the issue of independence. We were supposed to have the votes about that last year in 2014, but because we're not quite ready yet, we've postponed that referendum to 2018. As much as New Caledonian government is looking after labour and taxation and foreign trade, France is still very heavily supporting New Caledonia with education, healthcare, military presence and all the other security services over here. This is the generic sort of shortcut of politics. I've talked more, but then you'll start falling asleep quite frankly, so let's not talk about politics anymore. They're always complicated, they never make any sense in any country, and only there's not much different, to be honest with you. But let me start from the beginning. Because I would imagine some of you are here for the first time. So New Caledonia, after New Zealand and Papua New Guinea, is the third largest. Oh wow, you should clean your car. Yeah, that happens over here, guys. Take a deep breath and do not sneeze in now, do not breathe in that black smoke over here. Now, yes, after New Zealand and Papua New Guinea, we are the third largest archipelago in the Southwest Pacific. Our country is kind of made out of few islands. The largest island is called Grande Terre in French, which means big earth, big land. It measures about 400 kilometers in length and it's about 50 to 70 kilometers wide. So it's a very sort of slim and long piece of an island. Noumea is the capital where you guys are located today. It's located in the southwest end of that main island. Aside of that, we've got beautiful Isle of Pines in the south, four royalty islands, Lifu, Mare, Uvea, and various Motiga, and in the north we've got beautiful Bellot Island. And those are the seven largest islands of New Caledonia. Aside of that, there are hundreds, if not thousands, of tiny little peanut-sized islands, as we call them. The peanut size comes from the fact that they're only a few meters long and a few meters wide, of course. Noumea is a capital, is spread on the very irregular peninsula, lots of hilltops, lots of valleys, very irregular coastline, and you guys are going to be able to see that with your own eyes on our journey. But Noumea at the moment is the only large settlement as well in the country, aside of being the capital, which means it's very attractive for work, education, activities and so on. And this is why out of 270,000 people that live over here, yes, that's the total population of New Caledonia, 270,000 people, three quarters of that lives here in Noumea. So that's a lot of people squeezed in a small area. So the downside is that we do have a lot of traffic, property prices are quite high considering New Caledonia is tiny, and we're going to talk about it a little bit later on. In the meantime, that population is nicely mixed when it comes to different nationalities. Half of our population are Melanesians and Polynesians. They make about 55% of our population. Melanesians include the indigenous people of New Caledonia called Kanaks, people from Vanuatu Islands and Solomon, whereas Polynesians include people from Wallis and Futuna, Tahiti, and other French Polynesian places. second largest group over here are Europeans. We make about 30-35% of our population. They're mainly French, of course. That group includes Caledonians as well, the descendants of the first French settlers. And then we've got all the other European communities here as well. Third group is of Asian origins. They're mainly Vietnamese and Indonesian, and they arrived over here in New Caledonia at the same time when the French did, so they've been living here for as long as the French are. And after that, we've got people from Japan, Thailand, Cambodia, India, China, are living here as well. And then lastly, but not leastly, will be you guys, our neighbors, the Aussies, Kiwis, Americans, and Canadians. So as you can see, it's a nice international mix over here. Official languages, French, of course. Kanak people, they have about 28 different dialects, depending on which part of the country they come from. And English is kind of widely spoken over here. However, people are still very shy. Kids study in English in schools since about two or three generations, and then local communities, they've been introduced to English as well during the Second World War and also during the missionary times. And then of course all of us in the tourism industry, well, we speak perfect English. We want your money, of course, so hey, we have to speak perfect English. But don't worry guys, bad sense of humor again. We don't chase you to buy things. If you don't want to buy anything, don't worry. It's no harm done. For us, it's more important that you have a good time over here. You enjoy our activities. You enjoy our company and our country. And then you come back for more. You tell others to come over here. Right, guys. Well, slowly, we're going to approach our first viewpoint stop. Yes, we're going to have a few stops on our journey today. One of them has a nice little surprise waiting for you as well. Well, this particular stop over here is going to be within that garden that you can see on your left-hand side. For the Catholic population, that garden is considered to be an open space church. So I'm going to ask you kindly, guys, inside of the garden, do not run, do not make too much noise. And also at the very end of the garden here by the fence, you're going to find big rocks. Those rocks very often are used as a seating area. So please do not climb to the top of those rocks or do not stay on those rocks. At the end of that garden, as you can see on your left-hand side, you're going to have a nice view of the Noumea Peninsula. From the north to the south, this way it goes. The vegetation around the garden is half introduced, half native. The statue of St. Mary itself was actually made in north of France in Brittany in 1996. And it was brought here the same year and put here on this hilltop to represent Catholic part of our population. Inside of the garden, when you're going to enter it, on the left-hand side, there's going to be a big rock with marble plaques. There's no one buried on site. This is a nice tradition over here that whenever people get healed or something good happens to them, they put a plaque on display to say thank you to the patron, in this case St. Mary, for all the good things that happened to them in their life. On the side of the cross station inside of the garden, you're going to have a nice view of the cargo terminal with your cruise ship nicely docked, and that's the same view you're going to have here on the parking site. The hilltops that you find behind the cargo terminal, the hilltops at the very end of that peninsula, in the 19th century that was an island, and that's where we used to keep our convicts during penal colony times. And if you're wondering where is that beauty over here smoking us nicely down the valley, well, that's our nickel smelter, which is the oldest one in the country. And I'm going to introduce you to the smelly business of nickel over here on the way out of this stop. Now, before you guys get off, let's do a few formalities. Right now, it's 10 past. Sky look blue, water turquoise blue. Get creative, clouds, birds, palm trees all over the place. But if you guys look on the left-hand side across the bay, you've got that big mountain there where the peak is hiding in the clouds a little bit. That's our Golden Mountain. In the 18th and 19th century, they managed to find a little bit of gold in the rivers of that mountain. But then that gold ran out, so the name of the mountain stayed. But today that mountain is important in our life because it produces us with all the drinking water. There's a giant water source on the other side of that mountain, and all the drinking water in New Caledonia comes from that mountain alone. And we're going to see that mountain many times in our journey, so I'm going to point it out to you many times so you guys are going to be able to take a nice photo. In the meantime, well, let's talk about that beauty over here on the right hand side. Yes, look at that beautiful brown and white smokes coming out. This is the oldest nickel smelter in New Caledonia. It was built in 1867. So it's over 150 years old. And that smelter is processing nickel for the mines that are located 100 kilometers north of Noumea on the Pacific Ocean side. We do open cast mining here, which means once they extract the rock from the mountains, they put it on the conveyor belt and that goes on the ships, and then they ship it to the nickel over here to Noumea for processing. Aside of that, there are two nickel mines in the south of Grande Terre. And also there's a giant one in the north. And the south and the north mines, they process nickel on site. And nickel is only found on Grande, on the main island of New Caledonia. You can't find nickel on Isle of Pines or Loyalty Island. And nickel covers about 30% of the territory. So that's not a lot, but it's enough to affect our agriculture over here. And as much as we already depend on imports, because the population is small and not many people make things over here, so we have to import stuff. On top of that, we have to import food as well. There are small agricultural fields in the north of Noumea that they grow easy growing vegetables, wood like vegetables as well, easy stuff because the quality of the ground is not very good. And that's enough to feed the population. There's not much of an export happening over here, only tropical fruit. If anything, and a bit of fish and seafood gets exported from here. Otherwise, we even have to import food over here because of that nickel. Nickel is a natural poison to many plants. The quality of the ground is not very good, so even food gets imported. Maybe from France, but also Australia, New Zealand, and Japan. Now, nickel industries over here are divided between the French, Australian, Canadian, British, Brazilian, South Koreans. And as much as they make a lot of profits, they have to pay a lot of money back to our government. Now, nickel is our main financial income over here in New Caledonia. That's what brings money to the country. Nearly 70% money coming in to New Caledonia comes from nickel, so it is a very important thing. Second income comes from fishing, and tourism is at number three. And you guys are still very important in our life over here in New Caledonia. That's simply because nearly 80% of our visitors over here every year are you guys, cruise ship passengers. Only a handful of 20% flies over here for longer holidays. And most of them will be family members of the French people that live here, or Europeans. Now, the most common products that you can get out of nickel will be, of course, stainless steel, nickel coins. Nickel is used in audiovisual industry to make batteries and parts of the microphones and other equipment as well. Nickel is used also in metal industry. They make all those joints to join all the parts and pieces of constructions, for example, and so on. And it's also used in jewelry to join precious metals as well. So there's quite a lot of use of that nickel. And I suppose the most interesting thing about that smelly business, because it is a one smelly business, and pollution happens over here. I'm not going to lie to you guys. Accidents once in a while happen by air, by water. There's, of course, landscape degradation as well when the mountains get erased. But the most interesting thing about that smelly business over here is that New Caledonia, as small as it is, it has nearly one-fifth of world's nickel over here. 20% of world resources all the nickel comes from here, so that's pretty amazing actually, that a tiny little island can have so much of it. And this is why since many, many years, New Caledonia was one of the top producers of that mineral as well. Now let's see, let's talk about that weather a little bit actually, because it's, to us over here locals, it's kind of, I'm kind of a local, I'm going to explain it later why. But it's kind of freezing right now. It's the middle of our tropical winter over here. But then some of you, I suppose, yeah, but some of you it's like a summertime. Well, New Caledonia latitude-wise is located more or less on the same level as Mackay in central Queensland. And that's a few degrees north of tropical tropics. So yes, tropical climate. We have two seasons over here. The hottest humid summertime, the hottest months in December, January, and February. Average temperature around that time usually it's about 28, 30 degrees. The highest temperature recorded over here was 39.9. Never even at the 40 over here, like Australians do every year. Well, as we're at 39.9, that's our record. But the summertime is very humid at the time. Humidity levels can go as high as 85-90%, so it's very hot, heavy, and humid altogether. Excuse me. Second season over here is the tropical winter. The coolest months are June, July, and August. Average temperatures usually over here about 18-20 degrees, but the lowest temperature we recorded was actually last year on Maori Island, and that dropped down to 6 degrees. So that's far from being tropical, of course, and we're kind of thinking that this year, actually, we might beat that record, so hey, fingers crossed we don't. We're not really in a hurry to beat that record, we don't want to have 6 degrees again, but temperature of the water in our lagoons stays the same at 23-24 degrees all around, and it only goes up before cyclone or depression. It goes up a few degrees to about 26-28, and so cyclones and depressions do happen over here very often around the summertime, the hot and humid season, and also during the two transition periods between the summer and winter time. And as much as Australia and Vanuatu had the category 5 this year cyclones, New Caledonia was quite lucky to escape both of them. take a turn over here on the left-hand side, and on your left-hand side you guys are gonna see a group of historical buildings. Those are the original infantry barracks built in 1863, and until today they are kind of occupied by the French army. The main building with the clock tower behind the gates, that's the French army headquarters. And the statue of a soldier with two cannons and the French flag in front of that building, that's our war memorial, in the memory of all the soldiers and gendarmes and other members of community over here who participated in the First World War, Second World War, other wars and other battles around the world, and the names are written in gold on the black marble plaques. We're talking about the wartime. Second World War arrived on the territory here in New Caledonia. The country was used more as a stationary base, mainly for American Army units, but also New Zealand and Australian armies. It was the American Army that has done a lot of work around the capital and around the country. They helped us to develop the place and build a lot of roads, hospitals and schools, and the two latter ones we still use until today. So in the Maya and in the country as well, together, we seem to have quite a lot of American memorials and monuments to remember the present. Australia's left us cannons, and we're going to see the cannons in our next viewpoint stop. New Zealand Army's left us a few things as well, and we've got a beautiful, beautiful New Zealand cemetery for all the soldiers who died, of course, fighting during Second World War. And that cemetery is located about 180 kilometers north of the Maya, in a beautiful cemetery in the middle of the beautiful forest. Now we're going to cross the Maya Peninsula to the east side. We're going to get to the coastal road on the east side of the capital, and then we're going to continue our journey to the south side. In the meantime, on your right hand side, next to petrol station, guys, you've got that big white cross over here. Well, that cross marks the spot where one of four guillotines used to stand in the 19th century. And you kind of just stand here where that white cross is. It was a very famous one, so you're going to have to excuse my bad sense of humor when I'm going to say that 27 most notorious convicts from the Maya prisons had the privilege to lose their heads on that guillotine. And the privilege comes from the simple fact that before they sent those guillotines over here, this particular one was used back in Paris. It was used to be a Louis XVI and Marie Antoinette. So here's the privilege. It's a privilege because it's going to be the Louis XVI of the same guillotine as the King and the Queen of France, of course. Oh yes, and it's the only guillotine that survived from the 19th century. To see that guillotine, you'll have to come here for a longer holiday, and again, you'll have to drive up north about 180 kilometers to a small town called Bourang, and that's where that guillotine is located, in a small town museum. In the meantime, I'm going to introduce you to the story of the convicts and the history altogether a little bit later on our journey. In the meantime, over here, we're kind of driving through one of our, again, oldest neighborhoods called Forward Blanchot.
Wait.
Maddie, what are we playing now?